Welcome to our worship on this the weekend of the 27th of February. It's the last Sunday before Lent, and today is the day we traditionally think about the transfiguration of Jesus having been revealed in all his glory to the disciples. So today that's what we'll be thinking about. We'll be sharing some prayers and sharing some music as always. You'll be able to join in no matter where you are because the words will appear on the screen. The psalmist said, "Give thanks to the Lord because he is good. His love is eternal. Repeat these words in praise to the Lord, all you whom he has saved." So let's join together and praise the Lord. And let's sing together, "Immortal, invisible, God only wise." If you've got a book, it's number 55 in the book. Sometimes I get surprised actually. I think, do I look like my mum or do I look like my dad? There are days when I wake up and I look in the mirror and I think I've become my mum. And some days I think, well, perhaps somewhere around my eyes I look a bit like my dad. In fact, one day Nicola said to me, "You look like Grandpa today." Oh, I'm quite sure how to take that. She said, "No, it's your hair. It's the way I'd done my hair." And I sometimes think my sister looks more like my dad than I do. I think I look more like my mum and my sister looks more like my dad. But really, it doesn't matter, does it? It's just a family resemblance. I don't think we look very much like each other, but others say we do. And it's strange because I can see the family resemblance in my children. Some days I look at Thomas and I can't see any resemblance in him at all. And yet some days I look at him and I think he smiles, he's got the mannerisms of Phil, of his dad. And other days I look at him and I think he's got my granddad's nose, he's got the shape of my granddad's nose. And then strangely enough, as we walk along, we both throw our left foot the same way. And I know that's the way my dad's dad used to walk. It's really strange, isn't it, how you can get lots of little traits from different people in your family. And different characteristics and mannerisms or physical features. And that sort of got me thinking, actually, I might look a bit like my mum, I might look a bit like my dad, but actually, I hope what people see in me sometimes is that I might look a bit like God. I don't mean an old man with a beard like we traditionally imagine him in some children's books, Bible books, but actually we've no idea what God looks like. But I hope that by following Jesus, I pick up some of his mannerisms. I hope somewhere along the line in my life that I've picked up some of those ways of being, some of those traits that Jesus showed us that means that we be like him and in turn like God his Father, God our Father. Because the more we get to know Jesus, the more we'll be more like him and more like God. And I hope that resemblance, that family resemblance that we've all got, let's be honest, we're all brothers and sisters in Christ, will show through more and more. So that's my prayer today. It actually says in 2 Corinthians 3, all of us then reflect the glory of the Lord with uncovered faces, and that same glory coming from the Lord, who is the Spirit, transforms us into his likeness in an ever greater degree of glory. Wow, that's something, isn't it? The privilege of being transformed into his likeness. I think I need to keep working on that. So let's join together in prayer now as we think about these things today. Let us pray. Immortal, invisible God, we cannot see you, and yet we know that you're always there to guide us. We see your majesty in all creation, the mighty soaring mountains and the life-giving rivers and oceans. May we never forget that you breathe life into everything that lives on our earth. Father of glory, you name the stars in the heavens and spread them across the sky. And amongst all this splendour, you made each one of us in your image, chose us before we were born, and placed each one of us in time where you would have us be. Almighty God, may we always seek your presence, to be more like you each day in all we do. As we come into the presence of your glory, we acknowledge our own unworthiness. We remember how often our lips have failed to declare your glory. Our hands have failed to do your will. We have seen your acts of forgiveness and compassion, and yet we've hardened our hearts and failed to respond. We ask, merciful Lord, that you forgive us our sins and make us worthy of you. We thank you, Lord, that through the gift of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you will pardon us in your mercy and love. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, so that we may reveal some of your glory to those around us this week. We pray all these prayers in the name of your Son, our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's join together now in the words that Jesus taught his disciples, and then we continue to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let's sing again now. We're going to sing hymn number 59, if you've got your book. Lord, the light of your love is shining, in the midst of the darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring on us. Shine, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth, do not bring us, shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, great Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on
today come from Exodus chapter 34 verses 29 to 35 and Luke chapter 9 verses 28 to 36. Both readings come from the Good News Translation. Exodus chapter 34 verses 29 to 35. Moses goes down from Mount Sinai. When Moses went down from Mount Sinai carrying the Ten Commandments, his face was shining because he had been speaking with the Lord. but he did not know it. Aaron and all the people looked at Moses and saw that his face was shining, and they were afraid to go near him. But Moses called them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the community went to him, and Moses spoke with them. After that, all the people of Israel gathered around him, and Moses gave them all the laws that the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he covered his face with a veil. Whenever Moses went into the tent of the Lord's presence to speak to the Lord, he would take the veil off. When he came out, he would tell the people of Israel everything that he had been commanded to say, and they would see that his face was shining. Then he would put the veil back on until the next time he went to speak with the Lord. Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 36. The Transfiguration. About a week after he had said these things, Jesus took Peter, John and James with him and went up a hill to pray. While he was praying, his face changed its appearance, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, two men were there talking with him. They were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in heavenly glory and talked with Jesus about the way in which he would soon fulfill God's purpose by dying in Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were sound asleep, but they woke up and saw Jesus' glory and the two men who were standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, how good it is that we are here. We will make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not really know what he was saying. While he was still speaking, a cloud appeared and covered them with its shadow, and the disciples were afraid as the cloud came over them. A voice said from the cloud, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice stopped, there was Jesus all alone. The disciples kept quiet about all this and told no one at that time anything they had seen. And now our next hymn is Singing of Faith number 20, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. The words will appear on the screen. Thank you.
Come out before him now with
Thank you, Tom, for those lovely readings. I know you really enjoy doing them, and it's great to have you do them for us. Thank you very much. Are you ever surprised when you see somebody and they're not in the context that you normally see them? If you see them a different way, perhaps, to how you normally see them? I sometimes think when I see myself, I catch myself off guard a bit, because some days, well, if you see me at home when I'm not going out expecting to see anybody, I've usually got my scruffy jeans on and a sloppy sort of top. I know we've all gone through a time, haven't we, in Zoom, where we've perhaps worn something nice on top and perhaps our fluffy slippers underneath. And why not? Well, we're all at home. You know, who do you see when you see me? Perhaps you see Alison the Deacon. Perhaps you see Alison, one of your ministers. Perhaps you see Alison, your friend, I hope. All through my life, people have seen me a different way. Nicola and Thomas see me as their mum. My mum and dad saw me as their daughter. You know, for a long time, I felt like I was always going to be quite young, which was quite nice, really. I was a librarian for a while, so perhaps I was somebody who was always going around going, shh, I don't think I did, really. I cleaned for a while. So in all truth, there were days I had an overall on and I cleaned. I was a Weight Watchers leader for a while, but I was only a Weight Watchers leader after I lost about 4 stone in weight. So I've obviously looked different over the ages. I was a dinner lady at the local school. I've been a local preacher. And now here I am, one of the ministers in Melton Mowbray. And I sometimes wonder how I ever turned into this person. It's really hard sometimes, isn't it, to match your understanding of somebody with someone else's view. I remember once when I was preaching years ago around Manchester, I was a dinner lady at the school at lunchtime when the children were small. And as I walked down the aisle, one of the children sat at the front said to the mum, "That's my dinner lady." And the mum said, "Shh, no, it isn't." And I was a walk past, I said, "Yes, it is." Because I think in her mind, she had a thought in her mind that this was the preacher. How could I be the dinner lady? But I was a dinner lady. I remember somebody once saying to me, "Alison, you're full of surprises," as they found out that I'd done a certificate at the gym to be a gym instructor, which I never used. I've been diving. I took up Phil's hobby just so I could be with him once. I hated it, actually. Didn't like getting my hair wet. So I've done all sorts of things, and I'll bet you have too. And whoever met you, whichever group you were in, would see you completely differently to perhaps how your family see you. And I thought then, actually, how did people see Jesus? I bet people saw Jesus in different ways. You know, what did his followers see as they got to know him? Did they know him as a carpenter, first of all? Oh, there's Mary's son, that, you know, the carpenter from Nazareth. Perhaps that's all they knew him as at first. But then they understood him to be a teacher, perhaps a wise man. Perhaps that's what some people think today. A great person to have around at parties, perhaps, if you think about the stories of the wedding and the wine. He'd be a great person to have around. You'd never go hungry, would you? What about the picnics? Everybody thought there was nothing to eat, and suddenly there was miraculously loads to eat. I should imagine there were people who saw him in very different ways and followed him for very different reasons. He was a healer. He had many human sides, but unlike us, Jesus was unique and is unique in that he's God's only son. Fully human and yet fully divine. Emmanuel, God with us. But there were a few close disciples, close friends that Jesus had who saw him for what he really was. Peter, James and John were particularly close to Jesus. And yes, there were others. But the closest of close people to him watched him very carefully and listened and recognised him for who he really was. And if you read the previous verses to the ones that Thomas read in the Gospel, that explains what happened. You might have thought it odd that Thomas actually started the reading with a week later. But what had happened was, during the previous week, Jesus been having a similar conversation to the one that I perhaps just had with you then? Who do you think I am? And in fact, he actually asked them, who do you think I am? And Peter replied, you're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. It was probably one of those moments where everything clicked into place, where all those things where he'd perhaps been suspecting, looking at the signs, and then, oh, wow, realised, actually, do you realise who this is, who's here? This is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. You could imagine him perhaps saying to the others, have you realised as well? Gosh, I think we've actually realised now that this is the Messiah. Rumours actually had been rife. Some people had said that Jesus was John the Baptist. Some said he was Elijah come again or one of the prophets. But Peter knew, he absolutely knew, he'd recognised Jesus' true nature. And that was the crux there, wasn't it? That his true nature was like God. But I suppose that Jesus knew that their understanding of who he was had to be absolutely unshakable. They had to be left with no doubt whatsoever who he was. Now, Jesus had already told Peter that he would be the rock on which the church was built. No pressure there then. But you know, that experience that they would witness that day on the mountaintop would just stay with them for the rest of their lives. Others had seen miracles that Jesus had performed. Other people had witnessed this teaching, the kind acts, his mercy. But many would fall away. Like I say, some perhaps just came for a picnic. Some came to see if he'd turn some more water into wine. People would have followed him for all sorts of reasons and perhaps followed him for a while, but perhaps not stuck with him. But Peter, James and John would witness something that was so incredible, something so amazing that it would confirm what they knew and uphold them in their beliefs for the rest of their lives. Now, when you think what the rest of their lives was going to bring, it had to be something beyond any shadow of a doubt to hold them through all the trials that would come. You know, Jesus never said they would have it easy, but what he did was make their faith absolutely unshakable, a solid, firm foundation. What they saw was so awe-inspiring that they actually struggled to retell what they'd seen. You know, his clothes were dazzling white, his face shone like the sun. It was white like light. How do you explain that in a society where the brightest thing you've ever seen is a candle? Where it would have been tallow candles, a little lamp burning. You know, we laugh today, there used to be an advert on television for soap powder that said it was so white, it was dazz white. You know, even that would have been dull by comparison. They just didn't have the vocabulary, so really the telling of it in this gospel is amazing. It was a truly remarkable sight. Jesus in his glory. They saw him in a way they'd never seen him before. And then, to top it all off, Moses and Elijah appeared. You know, Peter and the others would be very well aware of the scriptures because of their Jewish faith, and they recognised these men as symbols of the law and the prophets. It was absolutely no wonder they were in awe. Some people in a moment like this, I think, would have been dumbstruck. But not Peter, oh no. And that's what I love about Peter. He's a bit like me, he gives me confidence because he's a bit of a gabbler and a talker, someone who in a nervous moment jabbers on. That's me again, and perhaps doesn't know when to shut up. Perhaps he was just trying to make the moment last. Perhaps he was just so amazed. He was just filled with loads and loads of words. But can you imagine how stunned they were? And then a cloud appeared. A cloud appeared and the voice of God spoke. Even Peter was speechless at that point. In fact, they were all so terrified, they actually threw themselves to the ground with their faces in the ground. I could just imagine how absolutely frightening and terrifying. And, you know, this is just sort of stepped up by degrees, hasn't it, over the moments since Jesus appeared shining, and then the others appeared, and then I can only imagine perhaps a thunderous voice, who knows, God spoke. You really can't raise your face to God, can you? Look how God used those same words that they'd heard before. This is my own dear son, with whom I am pleased. Listen to him. That really got me actually when I read it. Listen to him. How many times in the Gospels does it say you have got ears, hear, listen, just listen? God is telling us all to listen. Jesus himself said, listen. Can you imagine it? They were the most privileged people on earth. They saw Jesus in all his glory. They heard the voice of God. And through all the rough times ahead, the trials and the punishment inflicted on them, they would keep this moment in their minds. Let me just read you this from 2 Peter. It says, Peter says, we've not depended on made-up stories in making known to you the mighty coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. With our own eyes we saw his greatness. We were there when he was given honour and glory by God the Father. When the voice came to him from the supreme glory, saying, this is my own dear Son with whom I am pleased. We ourselves heard this voice coming from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. So we're even more confident of the message proclaimed by the prophets. You will do well to pay attention to it, because it's like a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the light of the morning star shines in your hearts. It doesn't get any more obvious than that, does it? You know, you will do well to pay attention to it. This eyewitness account, this is not a made-up story. This is a man who was prepared to risk his life for what he saw, what he heard, and what he believed. Now, I can't imagine that many of us will ever have such a moment in our lives. But there are times, aren't there, perhaps, when we can say we have encountered God one way or another, in the kindness of a friend or a stranger, in the healing hands of a nurse or a doctor, in the kind words spoken in times of trouble, in the closeness of the Holy Spirit when we just stop and be in God's presence. Because God is always with us. Emmanuel, God is with us. If God touches our lives and our churches, we too must be transformed. It just makes sense, doesn't it? How can God touch our lives or touch our churches and us not be transformed? You know, we might not look like Moses did with a shining face, or look like Jesus did, so bright that actually probably our eyes hurt to look at him. The disciples might not actually have looked any different after the revelation on the mountaintop, but I'll bet they did. You know, they say, don't they, that somebody after a wonderful event, perhaps even a bride at the wedding, glowed. Can you imagine how different they must have looked after that revelation on the mountaintop? God's radiance shone through them to others so brightly that actually it continues down to us today. So my question to us all today is, are we prepared to be transformed? Are we looking for a mountaintop experience actually? You know, if there's a bright light in you that you can't see, I'll bet others can. Do others see that change in us? The brightness of God in our lives? Do you glow with that family likeness? We have to ask ourselves, don't we? Is our encounter with God changing our lives and changing others? You might think, well, I'm too old, or I'm too stuck in my ways, or I'm not clever enough, or talented enough, or dedicated enough, or prayerful enough. We've always got excuses, haven't we? Why? But you know what? God can transform any of us. He can use any of us to build the kingdom. And if he wants to, He absolutely will. Just watch out for that moment where God is revealing something to you this week in your life. And then we can pass it on to others. Thomas is going to tell you something now about a transforming moment. A small one, but a wonderful moment that a few of us were transformed in a small way. Enjoy it.
During the first major lockdown in the spring of 2020, Mum was told that the annual meeting of all the deacons, the diaconal convocation, wasn't going to happen in person. They would all have to meet on Zoom. It was a safe thing to do, but there were lots of disappointed deacons, as everyone looked forward to getting together each May. One of the deacons, Joy Everingham, a fantastic musician, thought it would be a good idea to set up a virtual choir. Well, having never done anything like it before, some of the deacons thought they weren't quite up to the job. In fact, Mum thought her singing was like a bad audition off the X Factor. But a few of them had a go, and this is the end result. A joyful noise to the Lord. Anyone can be transformed by God if they take a chance. Be brave and take that risk with others and see what God can do with your offering. Enjoy. So please enjoy this version of Sing performed by the Methodist Diaconal Choir.
Make some noise. Let's just take a minute to still our minds and our thoughts before we bring our prayers before Jesus and place them at the foot of his cross. Lord, we bring before you the world in all its turmoil, a world which is not as you meant it to be, full of love and peace. Instead, we have made it ugly and dark in so many places. Living Lord Jesus, help us to see your world anew, to transform our anger, our frustrations into your love and peace. We bring before you world leaders involved in making difficult decisions amid the conflict between Russia and Ukraine. We know that ordinary people will suffer with an escalation of this conflict. Living Lord Jesus, help these leaders to be courageous and strong enough to take a step back, to see the futility of war, to value peace. We pray that foreign correspondents, journalists, and all media will report their findings with a sense of truth and justice, rather than scaremongering, which instills further fear. Living Lord Jesus, we pray for peace. And now we pray for our local communities, for people we know who need our prayers, for those who feel lost, lonely, bereaved, or ill. Living Lord Jesus, transform us into the people that you meant us to be. Help us, Lord. Amen. And now we sing together hymn number 317. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. 317.
At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess him, King of glory now. 'Tis the Father's pleasure we should call him Lord, who from the beginning was the mighty humbled for a season to receive a name from the lips of sinners unto whom he came. Faithfully he bore it, spotless to the last, brought it back victorious when from death he bore it up triumphant with its human light through all ranks of creatures to the central height, to the throne of Godhead, to the Father's blessing. our hearts enthrone him, there let him subdue all that is not holy, all that he is not true. Crown him as your captain in temptations are. Let his will enfold you in its light and power. For this same Lord Jesus shall return
for joining me in today's worship, and a huge thank you to Tom for his lovely readings and for introducing the piece of music and making the slides at the beginning and at the end. He's getting quite dapper at that now. And thanks also to Anne for a wonderful prayers of concern. Thanks also go to Jenny for constructing the service and putting all my little bits of videos together and getting all the relevant permissions. So I'd just like to end with a blessing now. Lord Jesus, in your life we see the glory of God. In our lives we want to reflect God's glory by the way we live. May our lives shine with love. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and evermore. Amen.